Good morning, everyone. It is Resurrection Sunday, and today we celebrate the victory of Jesus over death. Today we celebrate the victory of the light of the world over the shadows of life. We celebrate the promise that we will too experience ultimate triumph over trials. I want to welcome you this morning. I want to say thank you for joining us. I am grateful for your presence, and I rejoice over your decision to worship with us. It is our desire that you will experience God's presence in our midst. Now, I want to invite you to give your full and undivided attention to the God of life who calls us to worship.
Hello, my name is Barb Schuster, and I want to welcome you to worship this morning. It's a new day, a day of rejoicing and celebration, a day of new beginning, the day of resurrection. Christ is alive, and his coming back from the dead reminds us that shattered hearts can be made whole. Along with the stone, our impossibilities are rolled away. Jesus' resurrection is the foundation of our hope and our very lives. So in the midst of fears of death, let us shout with joy, for our lives are hidden with Christ in God. With Jesus, we rise victoriously in this life and in the one to come. Let us worship our death-conquering King, our risen Savior. Let us sing, for Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Thank you.
I want to invite you to pray with me this morning. Let us pray. God of us all, we give you thanks for your love. We give you thanks for your grace and your power on this blessed resurrection morning. We thank you for the many friends and loved ones who have connected here with us today. We thank you for the signs all around us that remind us of new life. Today, Lord, we gather to remember and celebrate. We remember Jesus who healed the sick and raised the dead. We remember Jesus who consented to suffer and die at our hand. Today, Almighty God, we celebrate the fact that death could not hold Jesus in the grave. We celebrate that not even death is able to separate us from the love of God. We celebrate that the gift of new life that we have in Christ. We celebrate the assurance that we have of eternal life. We celebrate the fact that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in each of our lives, bringing healing, restoration, liberation, and wholeness, releasing us from agony and making all things new. With this assurance, we offer our praises, prayers, and concerns to you, Almighty God, hoping and waiting for the absolute establishment of Christ's victory in the world. Today, Lord, we celebrate and give thanks that in life, in death, and in life after death, we belong to God. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus, our risen Lord. Amen.
The scripture reading comes from Matthew 28, 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He's not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'" Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I'm going to read a poem written by my granddaughter, Virginia. We should know when we were hungry, "I am the bread of life." And we should never forget when darkness had fallen and all hope has turned to despair, "I am the light of the world." We should know, "I am the good shepherd." So we should never forget, "I am the gate." And we should know when you are the branches, "I am the true vine." We should know, "I am the way to live and to learn." We should never forget, "I am the truth." So we should already know, "I am the life." We should know when we were to die, "I am the resurrection." So we know that when we leave this earthly abode, "I am the life."
Friends, even though we are not meeting face to face, I want to take time to offer to God this morning. As people who like to give, we give our gratitude, our praises and prayers to God. We also give our witness and presence along with our financial gifts. You probably feel blessed. God has provided and continues to provide for all of us in ways that we cannot even describe. As a church, we continue to be blessed by your generosity. I want to say thank you for supporting the ministries of La Poor with your financial gifts. This morning, I want to pray, and I know many of you have been led to continue your financial support to our church during this uncertain time. Today, I want to pray with you as we ready our hearts and minds to give to God a portion of the many blessings God pours upon us. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, even in the midst of chaos and uncertainty, we recognize how blessed we are. We also acknowledge that it is you who faithfully provide to all of us. Your provision is all-encompassing, refreshing, and beyond measure. Today, out of gratitude, we will be presenting a portion of the financial gifts you have entrusted to our care. We pray for you to bless and multiply these gifts. May they bring healing, hope, encouragement to all people. May your name be glorified as these gifts are used for the expansion of your kingdom on earth. Along with our finances, we present our hands, hearts, minds, and spirits to you. We surrender and give all to you this morning and every day. May you continue to bless us by accepting us and by molding us into channels of blessings to the world. In Jesus' name, our resurrected King, we pray. Amen. Friends, remember, at the end of our worship service, you can visit our church's website and click the donate button on the top right corner. You can also mail in your contributions if you desire. Again, we are extremely grateful for your faithful generosity. Now let us continue our worship to the risen Savior.
Now, with joy and humility, approach the God who conquered death and rose victoriously from the grave, handing over all our hearts and lives before the throne of God, beseeching our Lord in prayer and crying out, "Christ is risen." Hallelujah. Christ, you went to the cross, suffered, and died. And yet you still defeated the grave. You broke the chains of sin and death for us and for all creation. May we never forget the power of the cross. May we never lose sight of the empty tomb. May your praises never be far from our lips. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Our Lenten fast has come to an end, and yet there are so many in our world who are still wandering in the wilderness, who cannot yet see the garden at the end of the journey. We are still in the wilderness of the COVID-19 pandemic. Be with us now. Be with those that are sick, those who are isolated, those who are fearful.
any and all who are grasping at straws, struggling with their new reality. Guide us all through the wilderness, that every tongue may proclaim, Christ is risen. Hallelujah! Today, we especially lift up those who face the daily reality of this pandemic, including healthcare workers from hospitals to nursing homes, and essential workers from first responders to grocery store workers. Protect them all from harm. May they know you are ever by their side. May they feel the power of the risen King guiding them through their day. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Be with your church, O Lord. Today our Easter celebration looks more like that first Easter than we are used to. Locked in our homes, uncertain and afraid, we long to be joining our voices together in praise. We long to be in worship together. Remind us that the power of the resurrection does not rely on our traditions or rituals. May we be overcome with the joy of Easter. Help us all proclaim, Christ is risen. Hallelujah. And Lord, we ask that you be with the dead and the dying. Give them the sure hope and assurance of your coming resurrection, that we will be joined with you and all the saints in the kingdom of glory. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ is alive. The God who is love has defeated death. May your hope be founded in nothing less than the promise of the resurrection. And so now, it is with the confidence of Easter people that we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Easter. Jesus dying on the cross and being resurrected means everything to me. Jesus changed the world forever and gave me hope, hope that someday I might be with God. He suffered and died on the cross for you and me. And I can imagine that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoso believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. From John 3:16. In John 14:2, it states, In my Father's house there are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. If the resurrection did not take place, this would not be so. When my mom, dad, husband, and child died, it was a comfort for me to know that they might be in one of those mansions. When my mom died, I had a spiritual experience. I was given a sign. And my mom and I were very, very close. She was a devout Christian woman. And I'd ask God if she could let me know that she was okay. So I felt a fluttering like of angel wings beside my bedside one night and a presence of God. But first I was afraid and I didn't know what it was. But later on it comforted me and I knew it was a sign that she was in heaven. I also kept seeing two birds, and they would go in front of me like this when I was driving in the car. And it happened so many times, like 15 to 20, that I knew it must be a sign. So I had asked God to tell me about it, and he revealed to me that it was my mom and dad up in heaven together. And what a joy it was to feel that. Another spiritual experience I had when I was giving birth to my son Brian in 1980. I had a vision of a white light, and there were angels on either side. They were singing the Hallelujah chorus, and I thought, how beautiful. But then 10 days later, my Brian passed away from complications, and I knew that meant that God had taken him to heaven. If I did not have Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, I would have no hope. But because of the resurrection, I know they are with God. Because of the resurrection, God has given me life, regardless of the circumstances I have been through. I have been given blessings and new opportunities in life. I love music. It means so much to me. It moves me. Because of the resurrection, I have this song that I really like, Because He Lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because I know He holds the future. Life is worth the living, just because He lives. He came to love and forgive. One day I'll cross that river, and death gives way to victory. Because of the resurrection, I have that hope. Because of the resurrection, too, I am inspired to be open in the ways God wants to live through me. I ask, what would Jesus do? I want to be the hands and feet of Jesus by feeding the hungry, clothing the poor, welcoming a stranger, and just doing my everyday work for the glory of God. But I feel I need God's help to do that. I need to look for opportunities to serve. I want to deny myself and take up my cross daily. But I need the support and strength of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I know to be able to do these things, I need to be prepared by reading the Bible, having a quiet time, prayer, going to church and Bible studies, anything I can do to enhance my relationship and intimacy with Christ. Because of the resurrection, I have been given the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is my advocate and counselor. He lives within my heart. Sometimes I know God is silent, but I know He has a plan for me, and I know His timing is perfect. And I'm going to end with a passage that really began when my husband was sick and at home, and I couldn't do anything to help. And it was from Psalm 46:10, "Be still and know that I am God." Happy Easter. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The scripture reading this morning is from John 11, a selection of verses. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary, and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" The word of God for the people of God.
Have you ever felt like you have been traveling the path from bad to worse? Perhaps you have. But let me tell you, you are not alone. Many in our nation feel this way. Many around the world feel this way. Even Jesus walked the path from bad to worse. The disciples found themselves in that same alley as well. There are moments life takes a turn for the worse. That was certainly true for Lazarus and also his friends and family. All of a sudden, Jesus' best friend got sick. His health condition worsened rapidly. One day, he was active around the house, getting out into the community and living life as normal as he could possibly get. The next day, he was bedridden, traveling the path from bad to worse. Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus, were really concerned. They knew something was wrong. This was more than just a cold. They could sense life slipping away from their brother's body minute by minute. So they sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." And when Jesus heard the news, he told the disciples, "Don't worry, don't worry. This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." When I hear the words of Jesus, especially at this time of pandemic, I find relief and great encouragement. This sickness will not end in death. And some people would question, how can you say that? People are dying. This sickness is ending in death for many. And yes, people, friends are dying, but that's not the end. Lazarus died from a sudden illness as well, but it was not the end for him. And that's exactly the message of the resurrection. Death is not our ultimate reality. But there is something else Jesus said. This sickness is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. I am sure the disciples didn't understand what Jesus meant. And perhaps today we may not fully understand how God is going to be glorified through all of these we are going through right now. I don't even imagine what God is doing or how God is doing it. But for sure, God is being glorified. Right now, we may not be able to clearly see God's work through all of this, but there will be a day when, in retrospect, we will be able to see how the glory of God is shining down on us at this very moment. I truly believe Jesus' words are true. This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory. Shortly after Jesus heard the news that his friend was seriously ill, Lazarus passed away. 4 days later, Jesus arrived in Bethany, the town where the siblings lived. Everyone thought Jesus was late. The sisters expressed this sentiment when, amid tears, they told Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But now, it's too late." It's shocking to see how the biblical narrative and our lives are in sync. How many times do we question God's timetable? How many times do we think God is running behind? How many times do we believe that God can do something only when there are still signs of life? How many times do we tell ourselves it's too late even for God? It was in this moment of questioning, complaining, and mourning that Jesus told Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life." Here is what the text is telling us, dear friends. When everything seems lost, God shows up with life-giving power. That's what resurrection is. Resurrection is God bringing hope when we think it's all over. Resurrection is God calling for a new time when ours runs out. Resurrection is God making a way, creating fresh opportunities when we come to a dead end. Resurrection is God doing the work regardless of our lack of faith. Resurrection is God bringing good out of devastating situations. Resurrection is God's life-giving power at work in the grace that at times we find ourselves. Philip was born with Down's syndrome. He was a pleasant child, happy it seemed, but increasingly aware of the difference between himself and other children. There was a point in his life when Philip was not fully accepted because of his differences. He was 8 years old when some boys and girls of the same age struggled with making Philip part of the whole group. It was the Sunday after Easter, a beautiful spring day. The teacher had a wonderful idea. He brought in big Easter eggs, one for each child. The eggs were empty, and the assignment was for each child to go outside and find a symbol for new life, put it in the egg, and bring it back to the classroom for a show and tell. The kids liked the idea. They were excited. So they ran out the door and all over the church's grounds. They collected their symbols and returned to the classroom. And they put the eggs on a table, and then the teacher began to open them all. All the children stood around the table. The teacher opened the first egg, and there was a flower. Everyone expressed admiration as they looked at the flower. Then the teacher opened another one, and there was a butterfly. Everyone thought it was beautiful. Then another egg was opened and there was a rock in it. Some children began to laugh. Others questioned, how's the rock supposed to be like new life? That's crazy, they said. But the smart little boy who had found it spoke up. That's mine. And I knew all of you would get flowers and leaves and butterflies and stuff like that. So I got a rock because I wanted to be different. And for me, that's new life. All the children were laughing. You know, after making some remarks about the thoughtfulness of the smart little boy, the teacher opened another egg. And there was nothing there. The children didn't like that. And as 8 years old would do, they began to complain. That's not fair. That's stupid. Somebody didn't do it right, they said. The teacher felt a tug on his shirt and he looked down and there was Philip. Philip was standing beside him. And he said, it's mine. That egg is mine. And the children began to say, you don't ever do things right, Philip. There is nothing there. And Philip said, I did so do it. I did it. I promise I did do it. It's empty because the tomb is empty. There was silence, a very full silence. And for you people who don't believe in miracles, I want to tell you that one happened that day. From that time on, it was different. Philip suddenly became part of the group of 8-year-old children. They took him in. All happened because of an empty egg representing an empty tomb as a symbol of life. That day, those children were set free from the grave of indifference and disapproval. Months later, friends, Philip died. At the funeral, 9 8-year-old children marched up to the altar, not with flowers to cover up the stark reality of death. The 9 8-year-old children marched right up to the altar with their Sunday school teacher, and there they laid on it empty Easter eggs. Here is the good news, friends. Because of Jesus Christ, we can experience resurrection and life not only after we die, but here and now. Because of Jesus Christ, we can walk out of the graves that are trying to hold us back. No matter the grave, you can walk out of it and experience new life. That's the good news of the gospel. With Christ, we die, and with Christ, we rise. We rise to eternal life, but we also rise from everything that is life-draining here and now. We will rise from this pandemic that is affecting our bodies. But I pray that we will also rise from the pandemics of greed, jealousy, hate, resentment, and mediocrity that affects our souls. I pray that we will rise from desperation, sin, and our delusion of self-sufficiency and power. May Christ lift us up. You know, after his conversation with Martha, Jesus went to the tomb where Lazarus had been buried. At the command of Jesus' voice, Lazarus came out of the grave. And all of a sudden, the path from bad to worse was transformed. Here is what I see in the account of Lazarus' resurrection as well as the resurrection of Jesus. We all deal with somber moments. Yet, no matter how rough and dark the path is, nothing in this world can prevent God from accomplishing God's best work and purposes in you. For God, there is no brokenness impossible to restore, no irreversible desolation or disappointment. God is not limited by anything. God is an expert in turning ashes into beauty. That's exactly what happened that Sunday after Jesus' death. The disciples were emotionally and spiritually crushed. They were afraid and lost. Yet, Jesus' resurrection began the rebuilding process that later resulted in a movement that has transformed the world. Easter, friends, reminds us that God is always working for our good, that God has the final word. No matter how dark, tragic, or hopeless a situation might be, the worst day or the worst thing is never the last thing. So you don't have to be overwhelmed neither by external nor internal circumstances and issues. As resurrection people, we can experience God's abundant life now. We can strive to live fully in the resurrection power and life we have in Christ. We can constantly pursue our new life in Jesus. The resurrection story is our story, which sustains our living and gives us hope and joy. You know, life is punctuated with pain and disappointment, but let us not shrink in fear and doubt and succumb to the evil and injustice that is so pervasive in our world. Let this Easter be personal to you this morning. Christ has risen from the dead for you. God pulled Jesus out of death and is able to do exactly that for you and for me. The Easter story reminds us that God brings life and light into our darkness so that we can recognize this Jesus as ours, so that we can experience his resurrection as ours too. So friends, this is Easter. And it is not only the resurrection of Jesus, it is also the resurrection available to us through Jesus. I want to leave you with these words. They are part of one of my favorite hymns. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. I can face tomorrow with freedom. I can face tomorrow with the peace and the victory of God. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, life is worth the living just because he lives. Pray with me. God of new beginnings and opportunities, for the power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead and for that resurrection power that is still at work in the world and in us today, we give you thanks. Give us the grace that leads us to faith, to hear Jesus calling our own names and to recognize him. And by your resurrection power, bring us out of the darkness and into life and light. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the room.
Friends, I want to bless you this morning, and I hope and pray that the resurrection of Jesus will define each of your days for the rest of your life. Now I want to leave you with this word of blessing. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
My chains are cut. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me.
Because he lives, there is hope.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
From our family to yours.
Happy Easter.
Jesus is alive.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Happy Easter, everybody.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Happy Easter from
Tim
and Claudia.
Jesus is the resurrection and the life.
Happy Easter from the Greenlee family.
It's Easter and we celebrate that Jesus is alive.
He is risen.
We raise a hallelujah for the risen King.
Because he lives, there is hope.
Because he lives, we can face tomorrow.